وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، in today inshallah ta'ala series of the series that we started last week, in today's set بإذن الله الكريم, I want to talk about the responsibility and the rights that the wealth has on us, the money that we make, the responsibility that is on us regarding it. And what rights does it have on us? And what is it that we need to do with this wealth? As I mentioned last week, that the wealth is a amrun fitri. It's an innate, natural thing. Humans naturally love to earn. It's something Allah built in them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's something that the humans have been doing for decades and years and all from beginning, as I mentioned last week. From Nabiullah Adam until today, humans have been earning. So is it amrun fitriyun? Like marriage is a amrun fitriyun. Marriage is a natural thing. Humans have been doing that from the beginning when Allah created Adam alayhi salam. But the Sharia, what it does is that these natural things, what it does is that it controls it. It adds things to it and it gives it lead ways, and sometimes it prevents it from things and doesn't allow it some things. And so you see that in marriage, the Sharia allows this, but it doesn't allow that in marriage. The same applies with wealth. The Sharia comes and it says these things are not allowed and these things are allowed. And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He spoke about the concept of earning and making money as a blessing on His creation. If you look at the Quranic discourse and you ponder and you contemplate over it, you find out that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He talks about it as a virtue and a blessing that He bestowed upon His creation. That's why Allah says in the Quran, وَجَعَلْنَا النَّهَارَ مَعَاشًا. Allah says, we made the day ma'asha. What does it mean, ma'asha? Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he's a great scholar of tafsir. He's a great scholar of tafsir and he commented on the Quran. He's a great commentary on the Quran. He said when it came to this ayah, أي جعلناه مشرقا نيرا مضيعا ليتمكن الناس من التصرف فيه والذهاب والمجيء للمعاش والتكسب والتجارات وغير ذلك. Ibn Kathir says, the word وَجْعَلْنَا النَّهَارَ مَعَاشًا means, we have made for you, mankind, we have made for you, this earth مَشْرِقًا. مَشْرِقًا here means brightened. Daytime, it's bright, you don't need lights. You don't need to use lights and lamps and street lights, they're not required. That's why street lights switch off at daytime. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He brought a light from Himself subhanahu wa ta'ala for the earth to be bright. Why did He do that? لِيَتَمَكَّنَ النَّاسُ مِنَ التَّصَرُّفِ فِيهِ, so the humans can move around on the earth. وَالذِّهَابِ وَالْمَجِيءِ, so you can go and you can come back from work. You see, sometimes have you not been on a road where the street light doesn't work and it's dark? Just the other day, subhanAllah, it rained so strong. It was hard to see the road. If you were driving on that time, on that moment, it was very hard to see. And then subhanAllah, I realized that we only value something when it's away. The Arabs, they say, al-mu'asaratu hirman. When you have something, you generally don't value it. They say, laylatul dhalma'i yuftaqadul badr. The night when it's pitch dark, the people value the importance and they realize the importance of the moon. Especially countries that rely on the light of the moon, they do. So Allah is saying in this verse that I made this earth bright for you. Daytime, look at it. You're walking, you're going around. Why did He do that? So you can maneuver on this earth to earn what? Lil ma'ashi wa takassubi wa tijarat. Your business. Your trading. Exporting, importing. Wa ghayri dhalika, other than that. So this is in the context of showing what He's blessed you with, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another similar verse. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, وَجَعَلْنَا لَكُمْ فِيهَا مَعَايِشَ قَلِيلًا مَا تَشْكُرُونَ وَجَعَلْنَا, we have made for you, O mankind. وَجَعَلْنَا لَكُمْ, we have made it for you on this earth. لَكُمْ أي فِي الدُّنْيَا. On this earth, we have made it for you. فِيهَا مَعَايِشَ. Again, what does it ma'ayish here mean? Al-Imam al-Baghawi, a great mufassir, another great scholar of tafsir. He says, أَسْبَابًا تَعِيشُونَ بِهَا أَيَّامَ حَيَاتِكُمْ مِنَ التِّجَارَاتِ وَالْمَكَاسِبِ وَالْمَآكِلِ وَالْمَشَارِبِ وَالْمُعَايِشِ جَمْعُ الْمَعِيشَةِ قَلِيلًا مَا تَشْكُرُونَ فِي مَا صَنَعْتُ إِلَيْكُمْ. He says similar to what Ibn Kathir said, that the daytime is for working and all of this. So Allah is saying, I did this for you. It's me. You didn't bring the daytime and you didn't do this for yourself. Then Allah concluded the verse with something very powerful. He said, قَلِيلًا مَا تَشْكُرُونَ. Little do you show gratitude to your Lord. He's done this for you. He's made the day for something you can work and you can make an income and you can... But قَلِيلًا مَا تَشْكُرُونَ. Little do you show gratitude. Little you show what? Little you show gratitude. You don't really show gratitude much. So inshallah ta'ala, I want to mention, how do you show gratitude to the wealth Allah gave you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. I hope all of you can write this down, inshallah ta'ala. How do you show gratitude in the wealth Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you? The first thing is, because the ayah, what did it say? وَجَعَلْنَا لَكُمْ فِيهَا مَعَيْشَ قَلِيلًا مَا تَشْكُرُونَ. Little did the people show gratitude to the blessing of daytime where you can make business and money. Little show gratitude. We want to show gratitude to what Allah has given us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first thing is كَسْبُ halal, earning halal income. To earn halal income. Because Allah has done this all for you, number one, you have to work to make halal income. Al-Imam al-Baghawi rahimahullah, he narrated in his Sunan, والديلمي في فردوسه, and al-Daylami also narrated it as well, من حديث عبد الله بن مسعود, on the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. He said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, طالب كسب الحلال فريضة بعد الفريضة. Earning halal income is an obligation after the obligation. Ponder here. Talabu, to earn, kasbul halali faridatun ba'da al-farida. It's an obligation after the obligation. What does that mean? Earning halal income is an obligation after the five pillars of Islam. Al-Imam al-Munawi and Abu Hamid al-Ghazali and others, they mention that. That it's obligatory after the person has come with the shahadatain. And the person has also come with the salah. And then the zakat. And then the sawm and the hajj. That the individual, he goes and he looks for kasbul halal. And of course, as we know, zakat is connected to kasbul halal. Al-Imam Abu al-Qasim al-Tabarani rahimahullah, he narrated min hadith Anas ibn Malik, another slight different wording. He said it, that the Prophet ﷺ has said, طَالَبُ الْحَلَالِ وَاجِبٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ. gaining and attaining halal is obligatory upon every Muslim. So this hadith is slightly different. Talabul halali. And he said it's wajibun ala kulli muslimin. It's wajib upon every Muslim. Al-Haythami, he said the hadith is hasan. He said sanaduhu hasan. I want to hear bring something to your attention. What does it mean to attain halal is obligatory upon every Muslim? There's two meanings it can have. Number one, as Imam al-Manawi rahimahullah mentioned, Abdul Rauf al-Manawi mentions in his Kitab Fayd al-Qadir, he said, it means يحتمل أن المراد طلب معرفة الحلال. It can mean it is obligatory on every individual to know what is halal from what is haram. That's number one. To attain Islamic knowledge on knowing what is halal from what is haram. So here, طلب الحلال واجب أي طلب علم الحلال والحرام واجب على كل مسلم. Knowing the knowledge of what is halal from what is haram is obligatory upon every Muslim. So this is the issue of what? علم الفقه. And the second meaning he said it could mean is, so the first one he said يحتمل أن المراد طلب معرفة الحلال من الحرام وتمييز بينهما في الأحكام وهو علم الفقه ويحتمل أن المراد طلب الكسب الحلال للقيام بمؤنة من تلزمه مؤنته والاجتهاد في المباعدة عن الحرام والاقتناع بالحلال. He said the second meaning that it could possibly have is that, which is the one I'm taking from it now, it is that it is obligatory upon every individual to find halal provision for himself and for those who he's providing for. Your children, your wife, your parents. طلب الحلال, to look for the halal, it is obligatory upon every Muslim. Meaning every individual who has to work has to make sure that he's looking for halal. That's obligatory. You have no choice in that. And that you don't bring that which is haram to your family and your children. Two things, brothers, which are connected with one another. You can't stay away from haram if you don't know the halal. You can't stay away from the haram if you don't know the haram itself and if you don't know the halal itself. To study this, you have to attain knowledge for it. And there are some people who are sincere, they're innocent, and they're genuine, and they go into business, and they make money, and they've never consulted anyone of knowledge. They've also not attained Islamic knowledge on buying and selling. They're sincere like you. They never intended haram for their children. But then when they sit down with a sheikh and the sheikh listens to their business and the way it's structured and the way it's made, it becomes clear that this is not halal. It's haram. Your business transaction is haram. Now this poor person, inshallah, he's not going to be held accountable for it because of the fact that it was ignorant, inshallah ta'ala. But the problem here is, how is he going to get rid of this business that has been established for 10, 20 years, 15 years? How? Where does he start from? This is the tricky thing. The same way that you have advisors on your board in whether you should invest into a particular business and whether this venture is wise for me to invest in, it's also vital to have on that people of knowledge who know this science, who then can consult you accordingly. And if they give you a wrong fatwa, فَعَلَيْهِمْ, then it's upon them. There's nothing upon you. You're an am, you don't know. You were commanded to ask those of knowledge, and you did. The obligation is uplifted from you. Al-Imam Ahmad narrated this hadith, really, really, really touched me. And this hadith is very powerful, and we're going to stand over this hadith. If those people who are doing business today, and those people who are trading, if wallahi they followed this hadith, they would have attained success in their business. And they'll also have attained success in their hereafter. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said this hadith. This is a hadith and a statement of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. And Imam Ahmad narrated it in his Sunan, in his Musnad. Al-Imam Ahmad narrated this in his Musnad, min hadithi Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, radiyallahu ta'ala anhumah, may Allah be pleased with him and his father. Qala Rasulullah, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, please write this down, four things. And I would advise you all to memorize these four, to take this hadith and place it somewhere you can really look at. If you're working and you're making money and you're in trading and business, that you make sure that you know this hadith, at least the English from memory, if you were asked about it. The Prophet said, Arba'un, four. Ida kunna fika, if these four are present in you, fala alayka ma fataka min ad-dunya, there is no harm in the worldly issues that you have lost. If you have these four like him, whatever you've lost in this dunya, don't worry. Any business that you invested in, you lost, as long as you don't lose these four qualities. This is ra'sul mal, this is your capital. This is what you don't lose. In no trading or no business or no marketing venture, you don't. The Prophet said, حِفْضُ أَمَانَةٍ. First thing is that you safeguard that which you have been trusted with. حِفْضُ أَمَانَةٍ. Somebody trusted you with something. Be a person who upholds and fulfills that. حِفْضُ أَمَانَةٍ. Let's stand over the first one. حِفْضُ أَمَانَةٍ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in another hadith, Al-Imam Ahmad narrated bi sanadin sahih min hadith Anas ibn Malik, addi al-amana, give back that which you have been trusted with, ila man tamanaka, the one who entrusted you with it, wa la takhun man khanaka, and even the person who deceived you, don't deceive them. Don't let the deceiver be your teacher. Don't let him teach you what to do. Your example is the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Somebody trusted you with something. They gave you their trust. Fulfill it. And a lot of times, this is the things that people lose when they're buying and selling. The concept of trust. Countries that don't have strong governments, like where I'm originally from, people bring medicine into the country which is expired. They change the labels because there isn't a strong government to go and to check these things. And this is the beauty about when there is a government in a country. People don't realize this, but these are the things and the beauty of a system being in place. These things are observed and they're looked at and they're checked on. So people will come and they will import into the country expired medical things. People will change the amount of quantity that is in that substance. If it's this much milliliters, they'll take more or less out of it, and they will give the people less and charge them a high rate. Deception. Stay away from this. Number two, صدق حديث. Be truthful in your statement when you're selling and you're buying. People who generally buy and sell, they lie. Some people. They lie in their selling and their buying. You ask them, brother, do you have this product in your warehouse? Yes, I don't have it now. I have it in my warehouse. Give a deposit. Tomorrow I'll bring it for you. Okay. Tomorrow you come. He doesn't have the product. He's got another product. And then he says to you, but you told me you wanted this one. No, brother, I didn't. Wallahi, I didn't. No, you did. And then there's a mushajara and there's an argumentation. Kadhib, people want to buy and sell based on lying. وَلِذَلِكَ the Prophet ﷺ said, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْكَذِبَ. Stay away from lying. فَإِنَّ الْكَذِبَ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْفُجُورِ. Lying leads to transgression and wrongdoings. It leads to being a fajir, a criminal in the sharia. And once you become a fajir, what do you then become? فَإِنَّ الْفُجُورَ يَهْدِي إِلَى النَّارِ. And then the one who is a fajr, he is then going to be guided to the hellfire. Rather, there's another hadith that the Prophet ﷺ said, ثَلَاثَةُ لَا يُكَلِّمُهُمُ اللَّهِ. Three people, Allah will not talk to them the Day of Judgment. وَلَا يَنظُرُ إِلَيْهِمْ, Allah will not look at them. وَلَا يُزَكِّيهِمْ, and Allah will not purify them. Brothers, three people Allah will not talk to them, will not look at them, will not purify them. And from them is what?
Al-mufiqu sil'atahu bil-hilafi al-kadhib.
The one who wants to sell his merchant on lying. He wants to make sure that his merchant sells for him and his products sells for him by all means necessary. Whatever the situation is, he doesn't care. Hooks or crooks, doesn't matter. This has to sell. And so he gives you a lie. He says, it's not going to expire this year. It's going to expire 10 years from 5 years, 1 year. Don't worry, I reassure you, this is it, it's the best. Kidib, is it original? Is this the original? Yes, it's the original. They, yes, it is. It's not fake. Okay, you buy it. And then what do you find out? That it's not original. He wants to sell his merchant with what? Bil hila fil kadib. He swears, wallah, he's original. You tend to see that when you go to the market and you try to buy things from people, they will tell you this. Allah will not speak to that person the day of judgment. And Allah Ta'ala will not look at them. And Allah will not purify them. Sometimes people think lying is a necessity. Oh, I had to do it. I had no other choice. Subhanallah, I had to lie. And so they lie because I didn't want to, but what else could I have said? There was a great Sahabi, his name was called Zir ibn Hubaysh. His name was what? Zir ibn Hubaysh. They said Zir ibn Hubaysh never lied. He was never caught lying. It's a very hard characteristic, huh? He never lied. But Zir ibn Hubaysh, the people wanted to test him. They wanted to put him, okay, let's see if Zir will lie today. Humans are like that, right? They can't leave you alone. They want to see you. They want to... Banu Adam. Zir ibn Hubaysh, they wanted to see him. They wanted to test him. Zir had two sons who rebelled against Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. They rebelled against him. They did khuruj on Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. His two sons one day visited Zir ibn Hubaysh's house. They came to him. Their father. And Zir ibn Hubaysh was not like that. He never rebelled against no leader. Because the Sahabas never saw the permissibility of rebelling against a Muslim leader. However tyrannical he is, you're not allowed to rebel against him. So Zir ibn Hubaysh, the people said, okay, today we're going to see if Zir ibn Hubaysh is a truthful man. Today we're going to test him. So they went to Hajjaj and they said, Hajjaj, the two sons of Zir ibn Hubaysh are in Zir's house. They're in his house. Bring Zir ibn Hubaysh and ask him where his two sons are. So they brought Zir ibn Hubaysh to Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. Hajjaj said, Zir, I have a question. He said, hey, what's the question? He said, where do you know your two sons to be? Where are your two sons? Zir said, I just left them at home right now. I don't know whilst I'm with you right now or I was coming to you if they left, but I left them at home. They were in my house. Hajjaj ibn Yusuf looked at Zir ibn Hubaysh and he said to him, because of your truthfulness, I will not touch your two sons. Because of the truthfulness of your statement and how truthful you are and the sidq that you came with, I will leave your two sons. I will not touch them. And Hajjaj killed 120,000 people. He killed Abdullah ibn Zubayr. He hanged him in the Kaaba. He never left no one. What we take from this is, sometimes you may think lying might solve a problem for you, but you have to lie because of that lie that you lied. And then another lie has to be backed up with it. Truthfulness may reach you, will reach you into better places, even if you think that situation is tight and hard. إِنَّ الْكَذِبَ إِيَّاكُمَ الْكَذِبَ فَإِنَّ الْكَذِبَ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْفُجُورِ وَإِنَّ الْفُجُورَ يَهْدِي إِلَى النَّارِ. It will lead you to the hellfire. Even if the person doesn't buy your product, they know you as a truthful person. صدق. You're a صادق. And historically,
It was mentioned in the tarikh and the history, the way that the Muslims conquered. I shouldn't use the word conquered because it wasn't conquered. But the way that the Muslims took control over Indonesia, it was through the merchandise and the selling and the buying. The Muslims would buy and sell things to the non-Muslims. And if the non-Muslim had products, or if the non-Muslim was looking for a particular product and was looking for things that had a particular feature, the Muslim would say to the non-Muslim, let me tell you the truth, my product is not as good as what you're looking for. It's not. My brother over there who's selling the same, roughly the same product, he has a better version of mine. Go to him and buy it from him. You will be better off with buying it from him. And he will go and buy it. And this caught the attention of the non-Muslims. They were amazed that people will buy and sell like this. Ease. Samhun idha ba'a. Simplicity and ease when they buy and they sell. This is what they were known for. Like in some people, they love this argumentation. If they have to have 10, 15 people they argue with every day before they leave there. The third characteristic is حسن خليقة, good manners. The Prophet ﷺ said the third characteristic is حسن خليقة, good manners and good akhlaq. It's very important in business and buying and selling, you have good manners. As I said to you before, you are you're following the Prophet ﷺ. These individuals around you who are you're dealing with should not get into your discipline. A lot of people, they say, I acted this way because this person is like this. No. You don't learn from these people. You don't take their characteristics and you don't adopt it. The Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, Al-Imam al-Bukhari narrated it, and Bazzar min hadith Abi Huraira, the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, innama bu'ithtu, I was sent out, li'utammima makarim al-akhlaq. And you know what's actually really amazing? The word that's used in the hadith is innama. And innama is min adawat al-hasr, which is ithbatul hukmi lil-madhkuri wa nafihu amma adah. Innama, it means, I was not sent for anything else. That's what it means. That's what the word innama means. I was not sent for anything else but to perfect people's manners. And of course, the first manners that a person needs to perfect is the way he speaks about Allah Azza wa Jalla. Not to attribute to Allah a child. That is bad manners to Allah Azza wa Jalla. تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَطَّرْنَ مِنْهُمْ وَتَنْشَقُّ الْأَرْضُ وَتَخِرُّ الْجِبَالُ هَدًّا أَنْ دَعُوا لِلرَّحْمَنِ وَلَدًا وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لِلرَّحْمَنِ أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُ وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لِلرَّحْمَنِ أَنْ يَتَّخِذَ وَلَدًا. Bad manners to say Allah has a child. So the Prophet ﷺ, if you look at what he came with, is good manners. Akhlaq. This is what is needed. The Prophet ﷺ said in another hadith, Bukhari narrated, إِنَّ مِنْ أَحَبِّكُمْ, the people who are most beloved to me, the messenger saying this, وَأَقْرَبِكُمْ مِنِّي مَجْلِسًا, and are closest to me in sit, in the day of judgment, who are closest to me the day of judgment, Ahu ahasinukum akhlaqa, the one that has the best manners. The day of judgment, the people who are with the Prophet, who are going to sit with the Prophet, who are going to be next to the Prophet, are the ones who have good manners. Good akhlaq. So when you're buying or you're selling, the Salaf, rahimahumullah, they mentioned, what does good akhlaq mean? Okay, we know good akhlaq. What does it mean? Good akhlaq means kaful adha wa ihtimalul mu'mineen. Jamharat min al-Salaf, they said this. It is to withhold your harm from the Muslims. Don't harm anyone. Kaful adha. Don't bring harm to people. And then what? To endure what comes from the people. That's the meaning of good manners. You don't harm people. And when it comes, harm is put on you, you endure it. You have forbearance to know how to deal with it. And not necessarily retaliate in every situation. Somebody does something, you shout in the market, and you scream, and you... We all know the famous hadith, and I'm going to mention this inshallah ta'ala in the series, that a prophet, that our messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, in a buying and a selling, he was sallallahu alayhi wasalam by a man. He said to the Prophet, you're lying. In a trading, bring a witness. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam went and he called onto, the Prophet looked, not knowing that he didn't have a witness. And one of the companions stood up and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I'm your witness. I'm going to testify that this is the way you're saying it. And he testified it. This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. A man is saying it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in a business transaction. He said, you're lying in the trading. Bring a witness. And the Prophet ﷺ went, didn't get foul language and fight. And this noble companion, he testified for the Prophet ﷺ, and from that day onwards, his testimony was equal to two men. That one companion. Does anyone remember his name? The name of that Sahabi? I don't remember the name of the companion. The Prophet ﷺ said in another hadith, Ahmad narrated and Abu Dawood, he said, أَكْمَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِيمَانًا أَحْسَنُهُمْ خُلُقًا أَحْسَنُهُمْ أَخْلَاقًا. The mu'min who has the completest iman, the mu'min who has the completest iman is the one who has the completest etiquettes and manners and akhlaq. It's very important. Number four, the fourth characteristics is what? عِفَّةٌ فِي طُعْمَةٍ. Chastity in your what? In what you eat. You're an individual who stays away from haram income. عِفَّة is to be chaste. I'm a chaste, so however you pronounce it. عِفَّةٌ فِي طُعْمَةٍ. You're an individual, you believe in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّنٌ. The halal is clear. وَإِنَّ الْحَرَامَ بَيِّنٌ. And the haram is clear. وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ لَا يَعْلَمُهُنَّ كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ. And in between the halal and the haram, there is this ambiguity, vague. Many people don't know it. That doesn't mean no one knows it. The hadith says, لَا يَعْلَمُهُنَّ كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ. A lot of the people don't know it. But some people know it. But then what is what is needed from you here? You go to the clear-cut halal, and you stay away from the clear-cut haram, and you also stay away from that doubtful gray area, as they say. Stay away from it. Nowadays, what do we have people saying? Oh, it's a gray area, let's go into it. It's not black and white. So if it's not black and white, it means stay away from it. Don't do it. صح? إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّنٌ وَإِنَّ الْحَرَامَ بَيِّنٌ وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ. فَمَنِ اتَّقَ الشُّبُهَاتِ فَقَدْ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْضِهِ وَمَنْ وَقَعَ فِي الشُّبُهَاتِ وَقَعَ فِي الْحَرَامِ كَالرَّاعِ يَرْعَى حَوْلَ الْحِمَى يُشْرِكُ أَنْ يَرْتَعَ فِيهِ. The Prophet ﷺ said, the person who stays away from this type of business, he's like, I don't know, is it halal, is it haram? He stays away from it. What has he done? فَقَدْ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْضِهِ. He has protected his religion, and he's also protected his what? His honor. People will not slander you. When you stay in a grey area, generally people are going to be like, oh, that brother, they say things about you. Your honor is going to be protected. And your deen is going to be protected. How is your deen going to be protected? Because if you keep staying in this grey area, this which is not clear to you, if you keep dwelling in it, the haram becomes easy for you. It's a stepping stone to the haram. Also, the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, staying away from the haram, how great it is. كُلُّ لَحْمٍ نَبَتَ مِنْ سُحْتٍ فَالنَّارُ أَوْلَى بِهِ. Any flesh that has been nurtured upon haram, you fed this body haram, the hellfire has rights on you the day of judgment. That flesh, Jahannam has rights on it. It has to take its portion. يَوْمَ نَقُولُ لِجَهَنَّمَ هَلِمْ تَلَأْتْ وَتَقُولُ هَلْ مِنْ مَزِيدٍ. This day, Jahannam is going to take its portion from you. Remember that. كُلُّ لَحْمٍ. Every flesh, everybody who feeds himself haram. مِنْ سُحْتٍ فَالنَّارُ أَوْلَى بِهِ. The hellfire has rights over you. رَاهُ التِّرْمِذِيُّ وَحَسَّنَهُ. Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi narrated this And he graded it to be hasan. I want to say now, this wealth, you have to gain it in halal. You have to gain it in halal. And you also have to give it in halal. You're going to be questioned in the Day of Judgment where you got this money from. And you'll also be questioned in the Day of Judgment where you spent it. You don't just concern yourself with this money that you got. You also concern yourself, what did you spend it with? That's the responsibility and the rights that the wealth has on you. وقت التحمل ووقت الأداء. The time that you took on this wealth and the time that you fulfill it, both times. And that's what the hadith Imam al-Tirmidhi narrated in his Jami' من حديث عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تزول قدم ابن عبد a slave's legs will not move from its position يوم القيامة the day of judgment حتى يسأل عن أربع until he's asked about four things are going to be asked عن عمره فيما أفناه your life What did you spend doing in your life? You died at the age of 70, the age of 60, the age of 50, the age of 40. 40 years you lived. What did you do? What did you spend it in? You will be questioned in the Day of Judgment. وَعَنْ جَسَدِي فِي مَا أَبْلَاهُ Your body, what did you do with this body that was given to you? How did you use this body? You'll be questioned. وَعَنْ عِلْمِهِ Your knowledge. مَاذَا عَمِلَ فِيهِ What did you do with the knowledge that you gained? The volumes of books that you read. You'll be questioned the Day of Judgment. It's the Day of Questioning. Interrogation. اللهم سلم يا رب العالمين. Allah make us safe that day. Your legs will not move from the sight of Allah. مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ You will stand, you will not move from that position until you answer these questions. Until you have an answer for it. Your life, how did you spend it? Your body, the beauty that was given to you, the skin, the physical strength that was given to you, what did you do with this? Maybe question. Your knowledge, the ilm that you learned, what did you do with this knowledge? How much of it did you implement? How much did you not implement? Why did you not implement it? You'll be asked questions about it. وَعَنْ مَالِهِ Your wealth. مِنْ أَيْنَ أَخَذَهُ وَفِيمَا أَنْفَقَهُ Your wealth, where did you get this penny from? It's dirham, where did you get it from? Okay, good. Then where did you spend that? One dirham. Where did you spend it? You can't lie to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. There's no lawyer, there's no... there's nothing. لَيْسَ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ اللَّهِ تُرْجُمَانِ Between you and Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, there's no translator. Or a lawyer or a solicitor. No, none of that. Ali ibn Abi Talib said, وَيْلٌ لِمَنْ لَا يَعْلَمُ وَوَيْلٌ لِمَنْ عَلِمَ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَعْمَلَ Destruction is to the one who doesn't know. And destruction is to the one who knows but doesn't act upon what he knows. You will know this hadith now. You've heard of it. Every dirham and every dinar that you gain, every penny that you get, every cent that goes into your pocket, it's a question in the Day of Judgment. You'll be interrogated regarding it. So learn its responsibility. I'm going to conclude with this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet also categorized the people into types again. And Imam al-Tirmidhi narrated in his Jami' min hadith Abi Kabshah al-Amr ibn Sa'd al-Ammari radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Annahu sami'a Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam yaqulu. Abi Kabshah Amr ibn Sa'd al-Ammari rahimahullah رضي الله تعالى عنه he heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم say the following ثلاثة the Prophet said three أقسم عليهن I swear by them وأحدثكم حديثا these three I swear by these three things happening وأحدثكم حديثا and I'm going to tell you a hadith فاحفظوه memorize it Three things. The Prophet ﷺ has said to you, I'm going to swear by these three things. These three things, I'm swearing by it. that these three things are going to happen. And I swear to you by these three, does Nabiullah Muhammad require us to swear by Allah for us to trust him and believe him? We already believe him before him even having to swear by Allah. But what does it then become if he swears by Allah? It's become very serious for us, right? It's a very serious issue now. And then look what the Prophet said. وَأُحَدِّثُكُمْ حَدِيثًا فَحْفَظُهُ. And I'm going to tell you a hadith, memorize it. So every Muslim should try to memorize this. Maybe if you don't memorize the wordings, memorize the concept and the meaning. The first one is, مَا نَقَصَ مَالُ عَبْدٍ مِّن صَدَقَةٍ. Sadaqah does not reduce your wealth. Number one. Money you've given in sadaqah is not reduced. A lot of people think, yeah, I used to have this much, but I gave it in sadaqah, it's gone now. No, it's not gone. It's actually what remains. We all know the famous hadith of Prophet ﷺ. When he came home, Aisha says, hadith al-Tirmidhi, أَنَّمْ دَبَحُوا شَاتًا. They slaughtered a sheep for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ. The Prophet went and he came back and he said to Aisha, where's the shat? مَا بَقِيَ مِنَا. What remains from the shat that was slaughtered, the sheep that was slaughtered, what is left from it? Because he left and he came back. And she said, قَالَتْ مَا بَقِيَ مِنْهَا. Nothing remained. Meaning, I gave all of it out and only what is left is the shoulder. Because she knew the Prophet loved the shoulder. She said, the rest I gave it out. Only thing that's left is the shoulder. He corrected her and he said, بَقِيَ كُلُّهَا. All of it remains. غَيْرَ كَتِفِهَا. غَيْرَ كَتِفِهَا. Other than the shoulder. Everything other than the shoulder is what we have. Because it's the day of judgment. That's what we're going to be given from. As for the shoulder, we're going to eat it and it's going to go. Are we all together? مَا نَقَصَ مَالُ عَبْدٍ مِّن صَدَقَةٍ. Giving your money in sadaqah does not reduce. Yazid. It increases. Allah nurtures it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You all know the famous hadith of Tirmidhi. Allah nurtures it the same way that one nurtures his horse, the Prophet said. And Allah nurtures it with his right hand, the narration mentions. The money, Allah nurtures it for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا ظُلِمَ. Second one is, وَلَا ظُلِمَ عَبْدٌ مَظْلَمَةً صَبَرَ عَلَيْهَا إِلَّا زَادَهُ اللَّهُ عِزَّةً. And there is not a person who is oppressed and is wronged. And he came with patience, except Allah will increase him in honor. The Prophet swore by this one. Anyone who is oppressed and is patient upon the oppression that he was put through. Someone oppressed him and he responded with a type of servitude, which is what? As-sabr. Patience. Allah will increase him in honor. The third one is, وَلَا فَتَحَ عَبْدٌ بَابَ مَسْأَلَةٍ إِلَّا فَتَحَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ بَابَ فَقْرٍ. There is not a person who opens the door of leaving, of working, and walking around and begging the people, except Allah opens the door of in continuous poverty for the person. There's not a person who keeps begging, illa fataha Allahu alayhi, that Allah will open for you baba faqrin, a door of poverty. The person becomes even more. This teaches us that asking and begging too much brings about poverty, means internally you will never be content. Allah will take away from you being content. Contentment will go. You just feel the need of more, 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 more. وَأُحَدِّثُكُمْ حَدِيثًا فَاحْفَظُوهُ. The Prophet said, I'm going to tell you a hadith, memorize it. إِنَّمَا الدُّنْيَا لِلْأَرْبَعَةِ نَفَرٍ. This dunya is for four people. This is the hadith I'm going to conclude with. It's the same hadith, it's a one hadith. The people in this world are four type. The people in this world are four types. Abdun. Abdin razaqahullah. A slave, Allah gave him malan. Allah gave him wealth. وَعِلْمًا and knowledge. He's rich, he's got knowledge. Are you with me, brothers? They said like the great Imam Abdullah ibn Mubarak. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, by the way, brothers, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, Al-Hanbaliyu, he's a great Imam, great scholar. Great, great scholar. Please pay attention to this, okay? Abdullah ibn Mubarak, his father was a slave. And his father used to work for his master. So one day the master said to Abdullah ibn Mubarak's father, Hamdallah, and Mubarak, sorry, ibn Hamdallah. He said to him, go and pick me a juicy fruit from my garden. This is Abdullah Mubarak's father, Mubarak. Go pick me a good fruit from the tree. So he went, he picked up a fruit, an apple, and he brought it to the master and he gave it to him. The master bit the fruit and he said to him, did I not tell you to get me a juicy fruit? What is this fruit that you got me out of the garden? And then he said to him, all this time that I've worked in your garden, I've never eaten your fruit to know which one tastes nice or not. I've never eaten from your trees. I don't know which one tastes nice or which one doesn't. The master said, okay, go. He looked into his affairs and he realized he's afiful batni wal farj. A man who protects what goes into his stomach and that which he desires. He protects his private part and he protects what goes into his stomach. He married his daughter off to him. And he gave birth to the Imam Abdullah ibn Mubarak. Mubarak. Abdullah ibn Mubarak became so rich that he used to come to his city and he would look at the people and say, this year who wants to do Hajj? Everybody who puts their hands up, he will take them to Hajj. On his own wealth. Abdullah ibn Mubarak. Are we all together, brothers? Allah gave him wealth. Abdullah ibn Mubarak is from the Ruwat and Bukhari and Muslim and Abi Dawood and Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah and Kutub al-Hadith. He did the chain of narration. He's the teacher of Imam Malik. Great Imams. So Allah gave Abdullah ibn Mubarak knowledge and wealth. Abdin razaqahu Allahu malan, a slave Allah gave him wealth. Wa ilman, and knowledge. Fawa yattaqi fihi rabbahu. And in the knowledge and in the wealth, he fears his Lord in it. Wa yasilu fihi rahimah. And he keeps ties of kinship. I want to stand over this point a bit. Some people, when they become rich, they become cold and hard to their family members. They feel they've grown out of their parents and their family. Yeah, you guys, subhanAllah, you don't know what I've achieved in life. And they forget their family. They forget the people who raised them and brought them into this world, provided for you, gave to you. This first person, he has wealth and he has knowledge. He fears Allah in it and he keeps the ties of kinship. وَيَعْلَمُ لِلَّهِ فِيهِ حَقًّا. And he knows there's responsibility on this wealth of his. فَهَذَا بِأَفْضَلِ الْمَنَازِلِ. The Prophet said, this person is of the greatest level. Ilm and amal. Allahu Akbar. Allah gives you Islamic knowledge and Allah gives you wealth. And you know how to spend that wealth. You protect, where you got it from is good. Where you're putting it to is good. Family, everyone. فَهَذَا بِأَفْضَلِ الْمَنَازِلِ. فَهَذَا بِأَفْضَلِ الْمَنَازِلِ. وَعَبْدٍ رَزَقَهُ اللَّهُ. A man Allah gave him. عِلْمًا. Before I go into this, I know one man from my country. He's very rich, extremely rich, billionaire. He's got a lot of money. Allah gave him عِلْمٌ, knowledge. Allah gave him what? Knowledge. Islamic knowledge. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala gave him wealth. It's little in my country that you find at any Islamic institution that doesn't use his, that he doesn't provide for. The whole entire electricity in the country runs under him. He's like a government by himself. The wealth and everything Allah has given him. He's got the entire country's wealth in his bank because of a software he bought. With all of that, if you meet that man, I bumped into him one time, I prayed with him, assalamu alaikum, Shaykh, how are you doing? Somebody pointed out him to me. So I met him, assalamu alaikum, Shaykh, how are you? Soon as I said, he said, do you want something? I said, no, no, Shaykh, Jazakallah khair, barakallah fi. You can see in his raghbah that he gives. And that is one characteristic that is noble about him. Ma'roof. And the second one is, he does not let his mother leave his eyesight. Ever he goes, his mother's with him. He's shoulder to shoulder. She travels with him. Everywhere he goes in the world, she's with him. The food that she eats, what she drinks, what she has, she's with him. لا تفارقه. She doesn't leave his eyesight. A living example. So if Allah gives you knowledge and wealth, you can open many doors for khair. وعبد رزقه الله, a slave Allah gave him علم and knowledge only. ولم يرزقه مالا, but Allah didn't give him wealth. فهو صادق النية, but he has good intention. He hasn't got anything, but he's good intention. يقول, he says, لو أن لي مالا, if I had wealth, لعملت بعمل فلان, I would have done the action of so and so. So and so who spends his wealth in the sake of Allah, I would have done the same. I wish I had wealth to do that. But when he says, oh Allah, I wish I had that wealth, he doesn't want it to be taken from the person who has it. Oh Allah, increase it for them. And if I had it, I'll do the same. لو أن لي مالا لعملت بعمل فلان فهو بنيته. This person has his intention. فأجروهما سواء. Their reward is the same. Look how powerful the intention is. He doesn't give, but he wishes. He really wishes that if he had it, he would have done that. Both of them are, in terms of reward, the same. وَعَبْدٍ a slave, رَزَقَهُ اللَّهُ مَالًا, Allah gave him wealth. وَلَمْ يَرْزُقْهُ عِلْمًا, and Allah did not give him no knowledge. فَهُوَ يَخْبِطُ فِي مَالِهِ, he dwells in his wealth and uses it بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, with no knowledge. He doesn't study Islamic science, finance. He doesn't have no knowledge of this field. But he's got wealth. He's rich. He just spends it everywhere. Riba, khamam, this, he doesn't care. He does not work in line with the Sharia. And he doesn't have no knowledge. لا يتقي فيه ربه. He does not observe his Lord, Allah Azza wa Jalla. ولا يصل فيه رحمة. And he doesn't also keep the ties of kinship. His family are starving and in need of him. And he doesn't know of their affairs. وَلَا يَعْلَمُ لِلَّهِ فِي حَقًّا, and he doesn't know the rights of Allah on him. فَهَذَا بِأَخْبَثِ الْمَنَازِلِ, this is the lowest and the evilest of stations. وَعَبْدٍ a slave, لَمْ يَرْزُقُ اللَّهُ مَالًا, Allah didn't give him no wealth. وَلَا عِلْمًا, and Allah didn't give him no knowledge. فَهُوَ يَقُولُ, he says, لَوْ أَنَّ لِي مَالًا, if I had the wealth of the one who uses it in bad, the one that uses it in evil, the one that has disconnected from his family members, if I had wealth, I would have done what so-and-so does. فَهُوَ بِنِيَّتِهِ, this one also gets his intention. فَوِزْرُهُمَا سَوَىٰ, their sin is the same. Those are the four people. You pick which one you want to be, inshallah ta'ala. سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ بِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ.